Welcome back to Cryptids of the Corn podcast. Woo!
Yay!
Here in a minute, you're about to hear from the world-renowned Ron Morehead.
World famous.
Well, yeah. Literally, world traveler, Sierra Sounds. He gets into some really, really, really amazing stuff. So we're sneaking in here real quick. You'll hear the intro and everything like that normally. We're going to do our front of house stuff because we didn't want to do that with Ron. You know, right. We didn't want to take up more of his time.
Knock it out real fast.
So once again, like as always, you know, we have our YouTube. The documentary series is going to mostly be done through the YouTube. Speaking of which, the Kickstarter is still live. As of recording this, we are 73% of the way funded. So thank you guys for your really amazing support.
And gracious.
Donations and all that stuff. Yes. We do greatly appreciate you. And the ones that have donated, once it's fulfilled and everything like that, be on the lookout for some emails and stuff like that for like t-shirt sizes and whatnot. And if you want to support that, the link's below. And if you want to share it, also, the link's below. This upcoming weekend, or the weekend after, more likely, is the Monster Fest.
Sponsored by Small Town Monsters.
Yes. So Jay will be doing that with Rachel and Sean. I will not be there.
Mm-hmm.
So if you guys are coming, let us know.
Come see us.
Yeah. I'll sign some prints beforehand, and Jay can sign them at the event.
Right.
But yeah. So have fun there, guys. We're going to do a couple new reviews. We're going to stick with the Spotify side of it for this week. Okay. Boomer Lily? B-U-M-B-E-R-L-I-L-Y.
I have to look at it.
Bumber Lily?
Bumber Lily, it sounds like.
Yeah, I think I got it right.
Yeah, I think you did.
She says, awesome as always, gentlemen. I'm assuming it's a she. I don't know. Lily just makes me think of it.
Right, yeah.
Awesome as always, gentlemen. I'm always looking forward to the next episode. 5 stars all the way.
Woo! Thank you.
Thank you, Bumber Lily. This one's from the Little Tadpole. Thank you for shouting out Rex. If you guys want some to get in contact with some of the people who research with him, hit me up. Also, we have a lot of clay, just for the record. Thank you. So, you know, remember, we did the shout out for Rex, the Australian.
Yes, I remember that. So, she's from Australia.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks from down under.
But yeah, no, we'd love some more of his research or people that research with him.
Mm-hmm.
It's very hard for us to get anything of substance.
It's weird. It's like he's hidden
from the U.S.
Yeah.
And it may be that whole thing with, you know, just how the internet's designed and stuff like that.
Designed to hide.
Mm-hmm. And the joke that we also have a lot of clay, just for the record. Because remember, I was making the joke about ancient cultures. Like, they built all their stuff out of rock because that's all they had. They didn't have clay.
Yeah.
They do have a lot of clay. I don't know what I was thinking during that episode. Finally, the Patreon shout-outs, and we have a lot of them today.
Okay, let's get to them.
Okay, I'm going to do the hardest one first.
Okay.
Kashat Fireball?
Close. Yeah, let's go with that.
Once again, if I say these wrong, you're more than welcome to contact me, and I'll try them again.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, Johnny Knight.
Johnny Knight, welcome to the team.
Solar Flare.
Ooh, I like that name. Solar Flare. Is it spelled like... the same?
No.
Oh, does it spell like Ric Flair?
Flair is F-1-A-R-3.
Never mind. But thank you.
Destroyer Dawson.
Destroyer Dawson? Mm-hmm. That sounds... we're glad to have you on our team. Welcome. Destroyer.
Welcome, Destroyer. And Michael Winborn.
Michael Winborn. Finally, I just an actual name.
I know. It's like my brain went. Well, Johnny Knight is.
Oh, yeah, that is too. Okay.
I know a couple nights.
That's true. Me too.
Yeah. But it's just like, it's fun. You can do some of these really fun names.
Oh, yeah. I love it.
But thank you guys for joining the Patreon. Be on the lookout for our Patreon live events.
Yeah.
And then I know most of you guys picked the top tier. So after 2 months of that, like I think we're going to do it in July or August this year is the t-shirts for the $10 tier.
So stick around and
get
your tea.
Yeah, you got to be signed up for at least 2 months to receive.
All right.
But yeah, thank you guys. So this is pretty much it. Yep. You'll hear the normal intro here in a second.
Oh, sorry.
Enjoy the show, guys. Bye.
Bye.
There'd be a lot of poop in my hands. Seeing a 6-foot alligator go swinging through the air and slam into a tree.
These guys are the scientists of the supernatural, lecturers leaving lessons for inquiring laymen. They are applying the scientific method to a world that baffles science. They are the cryptids of the corn.
But who else has big black wings and red eyes?
Batman.
Oh, Mothman.
Oh, yeah, Mothman.
A great white shark was stolen.
Oh, someone stole a shark?
I got stuff for you you don't even know about.
She's a witch. She turned me into a newt.
Who knows? Anything could be possible. Anything could be possible.
It's really big.
Mm-hmm.
Abduction vibes.
Holy moly.
It sounds like you were abducted.
And it just stood up. I mean, it just like kept going and going. And she goes, what the...
Hello, hello, and welcome back to Cryptids of the Corn podcast. I am the great and powerful mystery.
And you know what? I'm just Jay today.
Just Jay.
Yeah.
Today, we are joined by definitely the most well-renowned person that has ever been on the show.
Yes.
Jay, you want to give the intro?
Okay. Oh, big pressure now.
Yeah.
This is the, well, the discoverer, I don't know, the recorder.
The recorder.
Of the famous Sierra Sounds. He's a world traveler. A public speaker, a former safety diver. Let's welcome the great Ron Morehead.
Ron, thank you for joining us.
How do you do? My pleasure. Fun to see you guys.
Oh, yeah. And we've hung out with you at conferences. We've had the great honor of sharing a speaking stage with you down in North Carolina. I never thought that would have happened. That was amazing. Literally the most famous person we've ever had on the show for any of this stuff. It's a great honor, so thank you.
Well, thank you. I'm humbled.
For a couple drunks from Northwest Ohio.
Right, yeah.
Oh, you're a good home, White Lightning.
Yeah, yeah. You know, we like to drink.
Good for you.
But in something Jay left off there is you're an accomplished author, and all, you know, I have all your books over here on the shelf, but do you want to just kind of go through and tell everybody, like, just kind of the basics about your books, and I'll have the link below everybody to purchase everything.
Well, anyway, I got involved in 1971 with a group of hunters, and we went into the Sierras and started encountering these creatures, and they were 8 miles in the wilderness, 8,400 feet elevation, so it's quite imposing area to get to. Nobody else is back there. And anyway, one of the guys got scared off so bad that he went out and got me, because I wasn't up there at the time. The other guys had said earlier that they'd been encountered some kind of monster up there. So that got me involved in the camp. I went back up with him because he didn't want to go by himself to see if the guys were okay. And they were. So I saw my first prints then and heard the sounds that they'd recorded, because they'd heard this thing earlier that year. And the other guys had to find out if that was real or what they were dealing with. So I say that I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. The Johnson brothers have been going to that camp since 1958. And this is the first time they've had these things that come around that they know of. You know, they may have been spying on them for years. They don't know. But Warren Johnson said he thinks one of them got burnt on the stove. And that's what started off. And so when they came out and told the other guys who had been hunting with them, which were my friends, they were all my friends, and they all went back up to see what was going on, and they got up there and heard the same thing again, really aggressive sounds, and one of the guys just got freaked off, and he left out the next morning, left a note, and said, goodbye.
Goodbye.
I get out of here. You can't leave at night, or he would have, you know, because it's just too far and too dangerous and all that. So anyway, he came out, and the wise word, because the guys didn't come out, so anyway, he said, I'll go back, you go back with me. They want him to go back and check up. So I went back with him. The guys were okay. So there, that lays the foundation for all this. And I ended up writing a book. We ended up taking Alan Berry in there in 1972. My wife says, slow down, Ron. So I'm going to talk real slow now. Well, like John Wayne says, talk low and slow.
Low and slow.
Well, anyway. But I get carried away with this stuff, so I end up talking a little bit too fast and running my words together. So if you don't hear something right, just ask me to say it again.
Will do.
Remind me to slow down. Anyway, we took Alan Berry in there, basically a reporter in 1972, and he ended up thinking it was a hoax, like so did Peter Byrne, so did Ivan Sanderson, who was a cryptozoologist back east. And Peter thought it was a hoax. They all thought it was a hoax. I didn't know this. I read the correspondence later on. And I found out that Alan, when we was gone out of camp up there, he was going through a PAX and everything else, saying, who could be doing this stuff, you know? Because it's pretty weird. It's way out there, up in the mountains, away in the forest, away from everybody and everything. And how could he be sneaking up there and doing that stuff at night, you know, to us and making these sounds? So him and I started becoming friends later on. At the time, we weren't friends at all. He was up there doing a job. We were up there just kind of having fun with it. And he was a professional investigator, though. So he ended up fostering the sounds that we ended up having studied. And so he passed away 10 years ago. And I kind of got the wand. I'm carrying it on and talking about it still. But he said, because he was a master's degree in science, he said, don't talk about the strange stuff up here, or no one's going to ask you to talk anywhere. Mm-hmm. So we didn't for a long time, but he and I started going out talking, but we didn't talk about the weirdness. Some weirdness goes on up there and other places too. But I've been doing this now for 50 years, and I hear more and more stories about weirdness and what's going on. And he said, if you talk about anything, stay with science up here. Don't get off in the woo-woo land, you know. Well, where does it go? I mean, how do you explain the anomalies we had going on up there? We're just strangeness. Lights, sounds we couldn't identify. I don't mean the Bigfoot sounds, I mean other sounds. Like I heard a big tuning fork, I thought it was, above my head, above our heads. It was daytime. I couldn't find the source of it. And one time we thought the camp was being torn apart out there while we was inside the shelter. And looked out there later when all the commotion stopped, nothing changed. Nothing was messed up, nothing different. How do you explain that stuff?
Mm-hmm. Right. Weird.
And one time we thought we heard a car door slam out there, and you know, you don't get a car up there. My gosh, you're lucky to get a horse up there.
I was going to say, you said it was like it's 8 miles by horseback to get up there.
8 miles anywhere you go.
Right.
Ride a horse.
Horse, car, plane.
I guess, yeah. But there's no roads up there. There's nothing like that. That you can't get to this place without a horse.
You can't get to or walk.
Yeah.
So we ended up hauling barrels up there to pack our stuff in, leave our sleep bags up there and stuff like that, so we could cable them to a tree so a bear couldn't tear them apart. But they did get into them occasionally. But anyway, we did that so when we did have a chance to get away and get up there, we wouldn't have to carry so much stuff in, because you got to carry it out.
Right.
So that's why we had the horses and mules, so we could take stuff in and not go through all that when we walked in. So that's how we handled the situation. And it was just, again, the strange stuff. So that got me into studying quantum physics, and that's what got me into my second book, Quantum Bigfoot, because I think there's an answer to any issue that's out there, but it is science. And I think I back up what I'm saying with science, and I got the professors that support it. And so that's, I mean, can they disappear? How'd trackway stop? You hear all this stuff all the time, but you know, you kind of put those people off because it doesn't make sense to us, because we're in a special environment. When you find out how things really work, all the way from the atom to the cosmos, it's under quantum physics, the rules of quantum physics. Newtonian physics only works within our environment, our 3D environment. And our eyes only work within light's frequency. Everything's energy, frequency, and vibration.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get into that, you find out that the light's energy, light's frequency, is between 430 and 770 terahertz. Outside of that, there's all these other frequencies that you don't see. Some people see ghosts, and some people see other things. You know, just you don't see everything there is to see. I compare that to like a bear's olfactory sense. They can smell 20 times better than we can, and 7 times better than a dog, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, if we understand our human limitations, understand how much more there is out there that we just need to try to understand. It's hard to do in this three-dimensional Newtonian physics that we've been raised in and that we've been taught. So, but there's more to it. Newtonian physics is 1687, Isaac Newton, you know, and it's based on everything being physical and material and measurable and predictable, and that's just not correct. Everything isn't. Everything you can see is, but not everything that is. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Everything it is. Yeah.
Right.
So no, I understand. I go with that and try to. I try to open people's minds up to understand that there's just so much more going on that we don't see. And I got into quantum physics because it is a science, and it will explain a lot of the paranormal, a lot of the woo that people talk about. It just explains most of it. Some of it you can't explain because it's somebody's imagination, maybe. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I know quantum physics. I relate it to in the back of my book. It balances or puts together spirituality and quantum physics are synonymous. So I was raised religiously, so I know the Bible. I'm not religious anymore, but I was raised that way, and I understood then when I started understanding quantum physics a little bit that they're synonymous. And even Tesla said that. Well, one man calls God, another one calls quantum physics. Well, that's pretty cool. And then you got Edward
what?
Oh,
I'm bad with the astronauts.
Yeah, me too. Edward.
Just Google it. He can continue.
Okay.
Edward.
Edward.
He said you need classical and quantum sciences together to have clear perception. I really like that. Mitchell. Mm-hmm. Edward Mitchell.
Edward Mitchell. I don't
remember my... Edgar Mitchell. There you go. Yep, Edgar, you're right. Mitchell.
So anyway, they all got something to say about another realm that most of us don't consider, and that's quantum physics. And I really get into that more than I do Bigfoot, because I think maybe Bigfoot has led me into this realization, how much more is going on and how certain certain things work. And then I find out that Paul Dirac, he was a physicist from the UK, he got the Nobel Prize in 1933 for antimatter. And can something disappear? Well, matter and energy are interchangeable. And that's most minute level of existence. We are energy vibrating at a frequency. Everything is.
Mm-hmm.
You find that frequency, you can change matter. That's Einstein, too. He said that. You find the frequency and you can change the matter. So that's how I think masters of old, Christ, Buddha, whoever, did their miracles. Through the laws of quantum physics. As they say, we can do the same thing, but I don't know about you guys, but I don't care how much booze you give me, I can't walk on water.
I've tried a couple times. I haven't been successful.
Yeah, you get pretty wet trying.
Yeah.
But it's fun to know how to work. Yeah, anyway, it's out there, and I think I just encourage people to look into it and try to understand what's really going on. It's, because we have two parts to our body too. We have the physical part, which dies, and we have the ethereal part, which is our spirit, our energy, our frequency, our who we really are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important too, to know who we are as humans. And that, actually, this Bigfoot thing got me onto these programs like this, where I could actually talk about that stuff. And it's fun because it's real. And I think it's until somebody kicks me out of this environment, you know, which that's the ethereal part. You go into another dimension, another realm, and that's, if you're religious, you're going to go to heaven, you hope, and if you're a physicist, you're just going to change forms. Because according to Stephen Hawking, Einstein, physicists, energy can't die.
Mm-hmm.
Never heard that before.
Mm-hmm. Can't be created, can't be destroyed.
It can only change forms.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. So, what do we change to when this body dies? Do we have to answer to everything? What goes on? A lot of people believe in reincarnation, multiple embodiments. I do. I didn't used to, but I do. Just because you got to answer to all the things with love and compassion. If you don't do that in this lifetime, you're going to have to come back somewhere or somehow and answer or figure it out. We all got some learning to do as human. We have not evolved as high as we have to. And you can devolve in this embodiment all the way up into the ninth dimension. You can go, you can do it. It's just a matter of, it's not like a stair step that you take. It's an awareness that you get. So the more aware you get how things are, the better you are. Your vibration increases. Mm-hmm. And the higher you can get your vibration, the better off you are when you do change forms.
Yeah.
How'd you like that one? That's pretty cool, ain't it?
Yeah. That's pretty deep, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, that's like the...
It's 10 minutes into the episode and getting into the fundamental like works of the universe.
Philosophical,
and the human soul.
Yeah. It's almost like when people get into... And I think it's kind of what led me into like all this, like the Bigfoot stuff. It just seems at a certain point when it comes to Bigfoot, it is like a spiritual type of thing. And I think it's kind of the stuff you're pointing to now, especially with your quantum Bigfoot theory. It kind of ties into that spiritual aspect that, you know, science doesn't really touch upon now. And then that's why they don't touch the Bigfoot thing or even want to acknowledge that it's real, is because it kind of leads you down that path of questioning and making realizations that it isn't just the material world we live in, that Newtonian, what'd you say, that Newtonian physics. That,
physics.
Yeah. There's more to it.
Newton. Yeah, more to it, absolutely. And that's what Professor Plack, P-L-A-C-K, he got the Nobel Prize in 1918, for quantum mechanics. He pretty much discovered, he's the father of quantum mechanics. That's where Einstein and Tesla, Schrodinger, or these different physicists of old were in. That's only over 100 years old, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And yet, we got, that's called modern science. That you've got Newtonian science, which is 1687, like I say, based on measurable, predictable. Well, if you look up at the stars at night and wonder, how far is it to the end of the universe? So everything's measurable. You ought to be able to measure that. How could it be an end?
Mm-hmm.
Good question, huh? I've asked that question since I was a little boy, and nobody can answer that. In fact, I asked a bunch of professors I was kind of involved in with a. I think I got kicked out of the club about that time. Said, come on, everything's measurable, predictable. Tell me how far it is in the universe.
Can't answer that.
Measure infinity for me.
Right.
But yeah, it's amazing. And then, like, I do think that the Bigfoot phenomena. So I had my encounter when I was 16, and mine was, I didn't have any of what people say is the woo, but we've had people on the show that I fully believe that have experienced the woo, like we've talked about, whether it's the orbs or whatever associated. But I think, like, you're like, if I'm understanding you right, that it is explainable by science. Whether or not we can understand the science right now is really the key.
We just have to understand that everything is energy.
Yeah.
Everything is energy. Even the orbs, you know, and the light that, I don't know if you've seen David Pilates, Missing from One of the Hunted, the light ball that, or beam that he's the exact replica of what my wife and I saw in 2016, 2 years prior. You're out there in the tent, and all of a sudden, you know, it's dark. We're not asleep yet, but it's getting dark, and you see a thing floating by, and you don't know what to do with that. You know, it's just a form of energy. But there's other orbs been seen up there, big ones. I seen a UFO up there one time. It's unidentified, big blue ball come down huge from the sky, and it just kind of got lost behind the trees when it went behind there. So there's things, and quantum physics will answer those things. I got to say this, though, the Bigfoot phenomena, it's also got me digging deep into that. And I think they've been a hybridization from an alien, possibly, and long before we were created. If you think about it, we just live in a 100-year bubble. Most of us, so you don't know for sure what went on before us.
Mm-hmm.
You just know what you've read, and I think maybe the Bigfoot creatures have been here for something like them. Have been here for eons, I mean eons, because aliens have been visiting this planet for eons, millennia. And it wasn't until probably 12,000 years ago or so that our race, Homo sapiens, was made by an alien. If you want to get to where God is, because there's another thing. Get off on the physicists, you know, who can always talk about, well, that's good. The scientists who stay within their box, their parameters, you know, if they go to church on Sunday and believe in the woo, they believe in God. They believe in God, they say. But they can't get out of their scientific box, which I understand, because you lose a lot of credibility if you're in academia and bring that subject up. And Grover Krantz lost a lot of, he passed away too, but he lost a lot of credibility because of that. And they take a hitting because they can't get their funding for the next project. They might even lose their tenure if they haven't got it. So it's a lot to do. Jeff Meldrum, I know him. I just spoke with him a couple weeks ago in Florida. You were there, weren't you?
No, we didn't. Our buddies were there.
Okay. Yeah. He's in that classical box, but he's got to stay there because that's what his life is all about. Mm-hmm. That's what he's been trained to do. And on his personal level, he has to change a hat. And I'm sure, because he's a devout Mormon, and he believes in a God. I know he does. I spent a lot of time with him over in Russia and Siberia. And so I kind of feel bad that he can't jump out of that sometimes. He's a good man, and he's got a really nice lecture when he does talk. But he stays within that paradigm, that parameters, I should say.
I was a biologist, and I was a fisheries biologist specifically. Yeah. I hurt myself a couple years ago, so I had to give it up. I had to take a much more relaxed job. Yeah, I agree. You can't step out of that field. Like when science says, or mainstream science says, this is what exists in this box, the second you step out of that, like that's when you lose your job. That's when nobody wants to hire you. No funding comes in. Nobody publishes anything you write. You know, it's much more political than scientific when it comes to that angle of it.
I think there's going to be a lot more exposure with all this stuff before too long. Too many people are seeing them. Too many people are acknowledging them. But I write about that in my book I'm working on now. Is what's going to happen if they do say, okay, they're out there. What are they going to do? What's the government going to do?
Mm-hmm.
Lay aside all these billions of acres? You can't work and can't go in there. They're a habitat. Or some legislature get a hold of it and they'll appropriate so many billions of dollars for a study that won't do any good at all, because I believe these things, a lot of them anyway, are able to change out of their frequency into another embodiment. And they can do that through the frequency change, the energy change. These people that saw them disappear, you know, I used to, like I say, didn't pay attention to them, but I do now, because you get into Paul Dirac, I mentioned a few minutes ago, got the Nobel Prize for antimatter, which is the direct exchange between matter and energy, energy and matter. They're interchangeable. That was proven by CERN in 2012 when the hydrogen collider did that. So anyway, it can happen. What happens then? You don't see them anymore, but the trackways will stop too.
Mm-hmm.
There's no density to them. These people that saw their trackways disappear, they're not crazy either. I had that happen to me. My daughter had a sighting. We found the trackway and it just stopped. I thought, my gosh. What do you do with this? You know, you look on the trees, you look for boulders, you look where it could have jumped to and look for signs, and you don't find a thing. You just don't. And the answer to that, I think, is they transfer their matter to energy. That's a lot for people to get a hold of, but that's quantum physics and it's a reality. It's been proven. So I don't put those people off on the crazy farm anymore.
Right,
it's very interesting. We kind of talked about similar things already on this show, with interdimensional creatures and such, that they have kind of one foot in this world and one foot in another, or a different plane, kind of like that, where they're like you're saying with their frequency, that they're here sometimes, or they're in the what we would call our physical reality, and then they don't quote unquote leave. They, like you're saying, they just change, and they're still here. They're just non-observable.
Yeah, I mean, they're not all the same. I'm going to put that out there, too. I think many different types of aliens have been on this planet. They mess with the genome of different species. For what reason? You can only guess that, but I think it's to hybridize their species to this planet. That's why I think a lot of these things are different. A lot of the old Native American lore say that they've taken their women, too, and bred with them, which mm-hmm. means there would be 23 pairs of chromosomes.
Right.
And that means they can interbreed. And if that's happened, a lot of them would be more human-like than others. And I don't know what we're dealing with up there, but it may have been just pure alien, because the trackways are more splayed. They're more, it's a little different than the Patterson track. I think the Patterson film is a hybrid, like they all are, but I think it's probably a diluted one. It's more human-like. Its tracks, most of them have tracks like that. A lot of them have tracks like ours. So that's another element that just promotes what I'm saying here. I don't think they're all the same. Some of them may have different attributes than others. Ours can talk, has a language. That's what's unique. We've had the science behind it. Dr. Curran, University of Wyoming, studied our sounds for a year. And he said, and he presented it to Anthropology Unknown in British Columbia. A lot of guys were there. People were there, scientific people. And he showed the graph, and he wrote his paper, he presented his paper there, and it shows that they can talk outside or whatever sound they're making. He wasn't a speech expert, he was an electrical engineer, showing the credibility of the sounds, that they were not speeded up, slowed down, they were not manipulated in any way, there was no 60-cycle hum, there was no funny playing going on with them, no toying around, they were real. Mm-hmm. That was a big deal because people say, well, they're not real. Well, they are real, and no one can debunk them because they are real.
Right.
And we're dealing with something up there which has some really strange abilities. I know one time Warren Johnson and I walked out of the shelter when we heard one of these things yelling outside there. We thought it had to be high in one of those big trees right outside there, about 30 feet away. And we started walking up towards a tree. We were getting kind of bold then because figured they weren't going to eat us by then. And we got so far, we both just got stopped in our tracks. And what to think about that? I asked a wildlife biologist about that once, and he said, we scientists can handle your fears. And I said, we weren't afraid. I got to tell you, we were not afraid at that point. We just wanted to see one. I said, so elusive. And we just both got stopped like a force field, like related to in my book. And he looked at me and I looked at him, we had to go back. And then, as soon as we got back in the shelter, it started screaming out again. It was toying with us. When I did ask the biologist, he said, well, then you weren't afraid. It had to be infrasound or pheromones. At the time, I thought, well, it must be infrasound because they're huge. These things are big. And elephants, giraffes, tigers, they all can communicate infrasound. So I put it for years, I thought it was infrasound that did that. And I still do think that. However, you got Scott Nelson, who's a cryptolinguist who studied these things in 2008. And he said that they have a language by the human definition of language. Now, we knew they were talking to each other, but until you get those professional behind it to say something like that. And he was trained by the Navy to listen for unusual languages and see if it was a language. And if it was a language, was there a deception in it? And he listened to our sounds, and he did it by accident, actually, and he came out and interviewed me and Al both, because he said, there's a language there, I think, and he wanted to study them. So anyway, we let him study them, and he made the statement they have language by the human definition of language. That means a morphine stream of words like I'm talking to you right now, makes a sapient sentence. No other animal on the face of this planet is supposed to have that. Not dolphins, not whales, not nothing, according to Professor Lieberman at Brown University. So that's why Al got debunked a lot of times, or I say debunked. No one would study him until Dr. Curlin got a hold of him, because even Dr. Lieberman thought he was an ex-student that was trying to fool him. Minnevee at the University of Washington thought the same thing. Actually played it to his students, and this is how people hoax you. This is how clever they can be. Well, Al was pissed because he knew he'd already been through that gamut up there trying to figure out who could be doing this, if anybody. And for them just to shove it off, that's not science.
Right.
That's not science. We sent it to another scientist, and she took $2,500 of her money to start studying. She came right back and said, no, this is human. Human, I hear human tones in there. And Al, being the scientist that he is, he got all over her. He said, give us our money back. You're not going to study him. He said, that's not science. And he even wrote to the people that funded her. He just was really mad about that. Because
I don't blame him.
My money, too.
Right, right. I'd be mad. Why wouldn't you be?
So anyway, he went through all this stuff with different people saying it's toy making, something like that. But thank goodness that Dr. Curlin took him serious. I said, I just want to study with biased or unbiased study, saying if it's real or not real, if there's any fun making in it or anything at all, I want to know about it. He thought it would be a better story if he could say it was a hoax, how they did it.
Mm-hmm.
but it wasn't. And then when Scott Nelson, the cryptolinguist, got a hold of it and said that, that put two big marks on our record right there. You know, here's one guy saying it's outside the human range, and so does Scott Nelson, by the way, say it's outside the human range. And it represents an animal 8 foot tall compared to the human vocal microphones.
Mm.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
You know, and the little clip that he studied for that showed how the vocal mechanism is. And then when Dr. Lieberman says only humans can do it, that puts all three together. They have a component in them, like we do, for language. And what did that? Who did that? I think an alien, some type of alien did that, because I don't think our who we are as a human, our cognizance, our sapience, everything we got about us, I don't think that evolved like Darwinism says. There's pieces missing in there that just don't work. And I don't disbelieve in evolution like that, but I think that aliens have messed with the DNA of a troglodyte, and there you are. You know? And different types of ones have done different things. Experimenting, maybe.
Yeah. So
I'm
right there with you with the theory of evolution that there's, yes, I do believe species adapt over time, sure, but there are some major gaps that don't quite make sense.
Absolutely.
When it comes to us in particular.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, there's, I'm Christian, so I believe in intelligent design and all that for that. So that's how I explain it, but yours is just as possible when it comes to that, because for how we ended up,
it's got both in it.
Yeah.
If you get back into the cuneiform text, which, you know, was for the Sumerian times, which dates back thousands of years, it was the first written language in existence, as far as the oldest one anyway that we could find. Just about all the languages in Mesopotamia and all over there, even in Egypt, comes from the cuneiform text. Slowly over the years and years and eons, thousands of years, it's all been changed around. And, you know, anyway, you get into that, and the word God, as we know it, is not even mentioned in those. It was Elohim, E-L-O-H-I-M.
Mm-hmm.
It's mentioned over 2,500 times in all these cuneiform texts. It's always, this is a hard one to swallow, what I'm fixing to say here. You ready?
Yeah.
It's always plural.
Mm.
It's always plural.
Okay.
Never singular, not one time is there a singular mention of God in there. The word God isn't even in there, but it's referred to as Elohim, even the Hebrew text. So you got to study all that stuff to really get a better picture of everything that's going on. That's what I've been doing for 50 years. It's really been fun and enlightening, and I'm not through.
Right, yeah.
Whenever you stop learning, you've lied to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
There's always more to learn.
Well, they say when you're green, you grow, and when you're ripe, you rot. So.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
I like that. That's a T-shirt.
Yeah.
That's a T-shirt.
I like that.
You got a question for him?
So keep green.
Right, keep green, yeah. Stay mm-hmm. evergreen. When it says, like, when you said, like, when it's referred to gods, I mean, what cuneiforms are written form of text, and I say, like, any time things could be written down, that's also a chance to deceive as well, you know, right? Even back in cuneiform times, that's still a possibility.
Yeah. Well, who wrote that?
Right, yeah, yeah.
And they say the Anunnaki wrote it. Powerful mm-hmm. ones from the sky. The shining one, that's what Satan was even called.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, morning star.
You really look at all that. Yeah. It's the shining ones, the bright, powerful ones. They were huge. And I think it's, Anunnaki. And you get into that, and yeah, it can all be interpreted different, but
mm-hmm.
but I'm not sure how you would criticize that or how anybody could. It's the oldest language, and everything comes from that.
True.
So,
I just like playing devil's advocate at times.
That's what he does with me.
Oh, that's good. No, but how many different personalities have you seen God have in the Old Testament?
Mm, yeah.
Quite a few.
Right, yeah.
And you think a man or entity with love and compassion at his root and his core wouldn't have all the people killed in a certain area like he did when the children of Israel went up my mind's
that's okay.
When they went up there and seen the giants, you know, when they went up into Canaan, land of Canaan.
Yes.
There we go.
That's also where where Goliath was, his brothers, and giants were up there. They came back and reported that there were giants up there. We can't overtake them. But God said, wherever God was, go up there and kill them all. And no mercy. Just go wipe them all out.
Mm-hmm.
Everything. However, I think some of them might have got away. You know, the Edomites. And the Edomites, if you look closely in the cave that Michelangelo drew, a picture, you see two of them in a cave, and they look like Bigfoots. Yeah, look at that picture.
I didn't know that.
Ooh, that just tickled.
That's interesting.
Tickled something inside of you.
Well, yeah, because, I mean, we've talked about several times whether the giants of old and Bigfoot are the same things or close things that are very similar. I don't know. I think I have a different opinion on it every day of the week.
Right, yeah.
But
that's good.
I'm sorry. Continue. Yeah. I mean, I change on Bigfoot every day. You know, it's just, it's you talk to different people and, you know, we haven't been doing this forever. I only know what I seen, and what I seen was in the flesh, and at least in the flesh and blood mode.
Right. Well, like he was saying too, there's multiple kinds.
Yeah, that's the other thing.
It's not just one thing.
Yeah.
And that, yeah.
And nothing, by the way, nothing, absolutely nothing is just flesh and blood.
Right. Ours was scared of a gun, and it liked eating chickens and horse feed, so it had. It had some needs.
There can be good ones and bad ones.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then there's that. And so we did an episode about a month back now with just UFOs and Bigfoots being seen together. And the number it's happened is astonishing. And we didn't even cover the Chestnut Ridge invasion on that episode.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just, it's crazy. It's like every state of the union has seen a Bigfoot and there'd be a UFO before, after, or during. So is that a part of that quantum sense, or what do you think on that?
Yeah, I think, well, I think UFOs are here. They've been coming here. According to the Huffington Post, a 2012 article they put in from an 1888 paper in Eureka, I think it was, Eureka Times, they saw a rancher and a bunch of Native Americans saw this big moon come down, and three crazy bears jump out of it. That's the first UFO report, I think, that's ever been written about.
You say three crazy bears came out of it?
Well, that would have been Bigfoot.
Right, right. That's how they described them.
That's how they described it all, yeah. And anyway, they say 20% of Bigfoot sightings have a UFO component with them. And actually, I've interviewed people that have seen them. I've seen a UFO at our camp when stuff was going on. And I talked to another guy who'd been hunting for years, probably about 15, 20 miles as a crow flies from our camp.
Mm.
And I know the mountain he was talking about, and he said he saw Bigfoot. Well, first of all, he was deer hunting, and this deer that he was, I don't want to say chasing, but the deer ran across a meadow, and he was standing there waiting to see if he could beat on it, and all of a sudden just froze right there at the edge of the meadow, shot back right by him. The deers don't do that, and he looked over there and had to be a bear or something. He thought, and there was a Bigfoot stepped out of the brush over there and just walked away. And he's at the same time he's witnessing a UFO. He witnessed a UFO for probably 30 minutes in the daytime. So that was a pretty good report. The guy's very, very credible. He's hunting with an attorney friend of his, and anyway, makes you think a little bit. Again, I don't think they're all the same. But I think when they do procreate in this dimension, they have to raise their young ones in this dimension, to teach them how to deal with us silly humans in this dimension. I think they toy with you. I'm quite sure they do. They toyed with us up there. You hear a lot of people report about them falling out of the forest or something, and you know, they hear something stop them alongside them out up there in the tree line, but they never see it. Well, I'll say they don't often see it. And they'll sometimes call out your dog's name when your dog's not with you.
Mm. That's...
And stuff like that. They might call out your name.
So...
They can speak, you know, within our frequencies.
Yeah, we've had people on and stuff that have had those experiences, and it's like, why are they calling your dog? Your own name thing's really scary in itself, but like, is it... Are they just mimicking? Do they know what they're saying? But, you know, they're repeating. Is it because we call our dogs like that?
Right.
He's like, I have a German Shepherd. I got to say Doug 15 times to get him to go anywhere. So out of any given time when we're out there, you know, that's the word I probably say the most.
Right, yeah.
But no, it's extremely odd. I like that thought that, you know, when they're born here, they have to be raised here and then they move on. But I do think the different types is a real, like, that's how it is. That,
yeah.
And I can hear the dog's whining in the other room because I said his name.
Yeah.
You heard me call him, and now he can't get in here, and he's like whining. It's weird. It's all weird. It's all amazing.
Yeah, and I think that's what keeps the rabbit hole of,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're just researching Bigfoot and hearing the stories. It's just always so fascinating because you never know what you're going to get when a new story comes around, you know?
Mm-hmm. Another puzzle or another piece of the puzzle.
Right, yeah.
Now, so for this UFO, do you think that they're – well, I guess it's a hard question for me to even ask. Do you think that they're directly related to the Bigfoot that are being seen in these same things, or do you think it's all – kind of semi-related phenomena that just happens to be popping up at the same time?
I think they're related. I think something in the alien world, the cosmos, has probably been here and messed, like I say, with the genome of a troglodyte and made him a Bigfoot. Or maybe they messed with the genome of a orangutan. I think they just different ones. I don't know what created the ones we were dealing with up there, but they may have just been pure aliens. I don't know, but they're just tall. They're big. My daughter's seen them three times. I've got a glimpse of one. My friends, we've all gotten glimpses up there. Except Al Berry never got a glimpse. But I'm not sure if they were cloaking. We never thought about cloaking at the time. I never knew about energy and frequency interchangeable like that at the time. Because you'd think that we would have seen them a lot more often, and that we would have... But we didn't, and they could be real close to us, and just didn't see them that often. And we set up camera traps. We tried everything to get a picture. We never could get a picture. And it's just they outfox you. Of course, we're underestimated at that time. We just thought there were some identified ape running around the woods, you know. And we didn't know. Bigfoot was not on anybody's radar at the time except mine. I mean, when I went up there, Bigfoot was on my radar because something's going on here and it's got a Bigfoot. And that's what we seen that and was able to.
That's Bigfoot. There's another. Yeah, there's another T-shirt quote.
Something's going on
here and it's got a Bigfoot.
Yeah.
I love it. But
I spell those two things separate words. So mm-hmm. Bigfoot.
Right.
It's
yeah.
got a big. Comma foot.
Foot, yeah.
But yeah, some of the stuff. So, and if anybody at home hasn't heard the Sierra sounds yet, we did an episode on it way back, like a year and a half ago. But you sell all that stuff on the website. You guys gotta listen to this stuff. It's insane the amount of like samurai chatter, but all of it, like the level of stuff you guys were able to get is just truly amazing. Personally, I believe it's the best evidence of Sasquatch that anybody's collected because it's been studied so much and nobody's ever been able to actually debunk it, that actually have done a full study. If anything, it proves it more. They find out more and more stuff for the positive, like you were saying earlier.
Yeah, you know, at the time this was going on, we had no idea. I had no idea that it would develop into what it has today. And you're right, it does have a lot of credit. It's got credibility behind it. I think that's what makes it so unique. The Patterson film is a good film, but that's all it is. And I think that's a diluted form of a Bigfoot. I say diluted, that's the word I use to say that they've interbred with humans.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what makes a lot of them have the same type of splay, the same type of foot. Ours is not splayed like that. It's not unique like a human's foot, like the Patterson film, Patterson tracks. Ours are just bigger, and they're more well splayed. That's like hard. They walk one foot in front of the other too, like mm-hmm. that.
Like a straight line.
They don't. Yes, and we found some in the snow one time up there too, that where the trachoids just stopped. It had a 9-inch track and an 18-inch track, thinking that was an adolescent and a mother, and it stopped, and we couldn't see the rest of them. So we didn't think much about it, other than they must have jumped out of there somehow, you know, if we didn't see more tracks. But now that I know what I know, what I think I know anyway, I going to say that part because we only think we know things, you know, until we die, we really don't know anything. We're going to get answers to all this here one of these days. So, and for those looking for the flesh and blood, I'd like to say good luck to them, but I don't think they're gonna have it. Just because if these things are what I think they are, they can get out of your visual range, and you just won't see them because they can cloak or get out of the frequency, which is like I say, 420 to 770 terahertz. That's their light frequency, and once they're out of that, you won't see them with your eyes.
Mm-hmm. They could be right there. You'll never know it.
You need like a Faraday cage to actually catch one.
What do you get? That's a good plan. If they don't sense it.
Oh yeah, true. Yeah,
how are you going to build a Faraday cage out in the middle of a woods and get one in there?
You got to drop it from a plane and be very accurate.
Very accurate. Cover it Nutella.
It has no time.
Nobody can resist Nutella.
There you go, Nutella.
But so with the orbs and stuff like that, so I believe they can cloak, and I agree with you about that. If they were fully flesh and blood or normal or whatever anybody wants to word it, that we'd have one in a cage. You know, they'd be on display in the Cincinnati Zoo here in Ohio. Like we would know, like
in that zoo specifically. Yeah.
So for cloaking, so the orbs, here's the thought I've always had is that I don't know if you've ever seen the invisible hunting blinds and stuff like that. Everybody at home, they refract the light around you, but at the top they kind of glow, but most animals ignore that. So I always wondered if it was something with their ability to kind of refract the light around them. And that's the orb you're seeing above them. It's this actually bouncing ball of light where they're having to pinpoint all of this extra, all this light they're refracting. And that's just always a thought I've had, but I do believe, I mean, cause we've had people, I have said that they see them walking and then they're just gone. They're just not there. You know, they're watching an eight.
Well, you've seen the, yeah. You saw the 401 that I was in.
Yes.
David Pilates, yeah. Yep. Well, the section right after me was this lady that was tree hunting and she's seen this picklization form move one tree to another. Remember that?
So that is, and then 12 miles from where we're sitting right now.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yep.
Yep. I
mean, well, there you are.
But yeah.
It's Ohio. You're in Ohio.
Yep. 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 So that was in Lima.
Same time, a group of people, kids in a school just a few miles from there, was witnessed a UFO.
A bunch of. So.
Spooky thing.
Sorry.
Civilization is what. Other people describe the same thing. And if you're not really looking, you won't see it. I had a person give me a picture of her. She was walking in the woods with her cat. The cat was out in front of her house, and the cat was stopped and started looking like that. She was filming this with her camera, and she just, from where her cat was looking, and it was like a pixelization form going by. And wow, that's pretty cool. You know, you don't see those every day.
Mm-hmm.
And, so anyway, I think something was cloaking there. No tell us what else can do that, you know, where again, I think aliens have got this thing figured out, where once we get out of this three-dimensional environment and evolve ourselves up a little higher, we'll be able to do the same thing, assuming we come back to Earth. And it's interesting stuff for sure.
Yeah, and it, like you said earlier, there's too many of those type of encounters to ignore. To say that it isn't a crucial part of the Bigfoot phenomena. It's just, you can't separate the two. And that's, I think, one of the biggest problems with the Bigfoot community right now is that there is the fleshers and then there's the woo, you know, it's all the same.
Well, I just want to encourage people to not call me into woo-woo because I'm a citizen physicist, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And quantum physics answers the woo.
Yes. Yes.
Most of it, yes. Anyway, the paranormal. It's just the laws that are behind what they're calling the paranormal or the woo. It's the law that governs that. Like Professor Dirac, like these different ones who've done these studies, and you know, very educated people. And you get into Edgar Mitchell, who made that statement, the astronaut. I like that one. He says it takes classical and quantum sciences together to get perception. And you got Einstein saying, it's just a fact. If you can find the frequency of something, you can change its matter. Well, there you go. We just learned to do that. Which I had a machine that would find all the frequencies, but you don't know what frequency to look for. Hmm. I think it's important that we open our pineal gland, our head, and receive information that's out there with a relaxed meditation state. And that information will go into your heart, and your heart will get a gut feeling that you're supposed to do this, that, or the other.
Mm-hmm.
But your heart needs to be coherent with your brain, this outside brain here. And if that's coherent, your brain will know where to go and what to do. So many times our education, our three-dimensional analytical mind will override what we feel like we should be doing, and we go that way instead of the way we're supposed to go. So I think that's the key to what I like to say on these programs is know who you are as a human, how you're made, how we're made to connect with this oneness that's out there, this one consciousness that's involved with everything, and how you can tune into it and by meditating, and don't be so analytical about everything. Your heart says do it. If your heart says do it, do it.
Right.
You're just kicking out the t-shirts today.
let me add philosopher to your
give me some credit for those. You're ready t-shirts.
Okay, yeah. we'll split it for you. We'll split it for you. Don't worry.
No, yeah, we'll quote your name on the bottom.
It'll be Ron Morehead. No, I'm with you that I think too many people go out in nature and don't experience nature. Like, they just ignore everything around them.
Right.
People just don't, like, ever realize how much life and how much weird life is around. I mean, animals that we have documented are extremely, extremely weird. Like, we joke about, like, mimicry octopus and all this stuff that they can camouflage, and you'll never know they're there. And there's nothing, they're not that higher, you know, they just are really good at what they do.
Right.
But no, it's amazing.
And nature's
cuttlefish the same way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cuttlefish do that, and so does squid.
Yep.
I've seen them all. And it's really weird. Octopus, I was diving up in Alaska one time and went out to this place where the giant octopus was supposed to be trying to film it. And I got up there and I seen this big tentacle out underneath this rock outcropping. I grabbed the fin of the leader of us and he come back here. And there's three of us. And he was trained with octopus, and he was the guide there. I say guide, he was a scuba master. And my son-in-law was a filmer. And he went behind this rock. I'm like, what's he going to do back there? He went back there. And my son-in-law got up there with the camera and scooped the octopus out. And he shot out. They never leave themselves without a way out.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy grabbed him just like that.
Oh.
This dive master, 7 foot tall.
Oh.
The guy's 7 foot tall. He's huge.
Yeah.
My son-in-law's 6 foot five. I'm not near those heights, but I'm looking at this. It's shooting black crap, you know, ink all over. its head was as big as the dive master's, and its legs, just his tentacles, just wrapped around his legs. And he just grabbed it until it cooled down a little bit, and he just started petting it like he would a dog. And then just let it go. But they don't want to hurt you. They're smart.
Right.
That's a really cool thing to see.
Well, yeah.
Ron, were you like a marine biologist or a diver or a scuba diver? What were you before you started getting into all the Bigfoot, like what you're doing now?
Well, I've been a little bit of everything.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
I've been a scuba diver. I didn't get my scuba rating or diving until early 80s, I think it was.
Okay.
I started diving a lot with my son-in-law. I've been all over doing that stuff. But no, I wasn't a marine biologist, just a guy having fun.
Okay.
I've owned a couple of airplanes. I've flown all the way into Alaska several times, all over Alaska, really, and flew it all the way down into Central America. And there's some expeditions, the Mayan expedition down there I went to. And I discovered some things down there, too. Really unique. But the biggest thing I think that opened my eyes was the trip into Bolivia and Peru. I flew into there. And I flew commercially down there. It's a long way.
Mm-hmm.
I met up with a couple scientists and Brian Forrester, who led us down there.
Yeah.
He knows that country better than the locals. You know, he's good. He's a wildlife biologist from Canada, actually. But he lives down there now, married to a lady from Lima. And he's a nice guy. He leads people out now all over. And he took us some spots that were really telling. And when you see that stuff, you know, alien remains or these big megalithic structures that have been there for eons, and they're put together like a jigsaw puzzle. I mean, just no mortar, just, man, quarried miles from where they were and up on this 13,000 foot mountain. And you wonder, my gosh, something with advanced technology had to do that stuff. We can't do it. I think we can do it today. Why would we? Why do they? You
know, right. It poses a lot of questions.
Yeah, it does. But anyway, it's withstood a lot of stuff. And that's one of the answers that somebody said was maybe it's for earthquake purposes. Well, that makes a little more sense. But again, how'd they cut them that way?
It was what purpose?
Earthquake.
Earthquake. Oh, okay. Sorry. I didn't hear it. Why did I don't know? I don't understand how that makes sense.
What, but the earthquake?
Yeah. Well,
so like when the earth quakes, and instead of one structure shaking, it's all the little ones.
Oh, okay.
So when it shakes, it doesn't actually fall apart and crumble. It's already got all the breaks in it. It just vibrates a little bit.
Hmm.
So the whole structure doesn't tumble down.
Some of those boulders were over 100 tons.
Yeah, gigantic.
100 tons.
Like some of the corners, like the Sacsayhuaman, I think is what it's called, like on the corners of some of those, it's just gigantic.
Yeah, I got pictures of that stuff. And when you see it to your own eyes, wow, it just, it's up above Cusco. You got to fly into Cusco and then get up there. But it's interesting stuff. What took me down to Peru to start with was the elongated skulls.
Like the Paracas people or something?
Yeah, the Paracas skulls. And we were measuring those with science and seeing the difference. They're about 30% more brain matter in those skulls than what we have in ours, and close to 30% thicker skull. And a lot of people say, well, those are the Incas who cradleboarded. Well, no. The Incas did do that, but they were mimicking the Paracas people, thinking they would get the same attributes they had, I think. We think, you know, them around to ask, but these Paracas people were had the elongated skulls. I think they were either part alien or all alien, because they have a single parietal. We have a parietal on each side of our head. They got a single one, no sagittal suture at all.
Right.
And more brain matter. They were able to do things. So those megalithic structures and stuff down there was all over high country Peru. I went into, I went all the way around Lake Titicaca too, up to Pumapuku and those places like that, and it's all over. I mean, the locals don't think much about it at all. They like the tourist dollar though, but
yeah.
But it's really interesting. It's an eye opener if you ever get down there. That's a thing to see.
Are those elongated skulls also like found elsewhere in the world, like not just South America?
Yeah. Yes. Egypt. Yeah.
Okay, I thought so.
Pretty much, I'm going to venture a guess wherever there's pyramids.
Well, there you go. Yeah.
If I had to guess.
About that.
Say for the most part, yeah.
I
know the island of Malta, I think, had some weird skulls in it, if I'm not mistaken.
All right. Yeah.
But I don't think I don't know if there's any pyramids in Malta. When I think about it, there could be, but I don't know. They have some weird stuff there, though. That's for sure.
I've never been there. But I've seen some information on it.
Well, let's go. You and me, let's go. All three of us.
You know where I'd like to go? I'd like to go to the Solomon Islands.
The which islands?
Solomon.
Okay.
Solomon Islands. Reports of giants there recently. I mean, it's fairly recently. And a lot of history there of giants. They used to be cannibalistic, kind of like the Paiutes claimed at Lovelock.
Okay.
But they live underground, supposedly, and there's UFO sightings all along there. And there's a story that about World War II, the Japanese saw them quite a bit, the giants, not the UFOs. And you ought to read that. There's a whole book out on the Solomon Islands, but hard to get in there and do what you want to do.
I'm making a note now.
Really, he's ordering the book right now.
You said my main things. The giants is one of them.
Giants, UFOs, underground. You hit all of his points.
Giants, yeah, giants in the Solomon Islands. And find it. So, what do we do without Google, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah. I know, right?
You have to call away and mail away to get this book.
Making notes. I'm making notes.
Now, the world is so much weirder and more connected than most people want to realize.
Well, it's just, realizing that that we are such a small element in this little timeline that we live in, linear time, that it's been here for billions of years, you know. And what about the cosmos and all the stuff going on?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm kind of anxious to join all that and see what it's all about. Not that I'm going to off myself or nothing like that.
But
I'm not afraid at all about...
About death.
It's part of life.
Yeah. I'm like, don't announce that you're going to off yourself on our show, please.
Yeah.
Don't be.
That's not that. That's not the headline
that's
we
not,
want from
yeah,
this.
That's not the. Yeah. Those cryptids of the corn guys.
Push Ron to the edge.
Oh, gosh. But no, just kind of like sum that up. My favorite picture is Pale Blue Dot, where the I think it was Voyager 2 took the picture of Earth from like a little bit past, I think, Uranus. And it shows you how small the Earth actually is in just our own solar system.
Yeah.
And the universe is, unending. It's infinite. You know, it's just massive. So to think that we're the only thing that has anything going on here.
Like Galileo, you know, he got on house arrest for the rest of his life for claiming the Earth moved around the sun.
Yeah. Yeah, he wasn't allowed to leave. Yeah. He almost got hung.
I mean, crimes against humanity.
Well, he didn't get hung. He got on house arrest. But people did get burnt and hung and everything for her heresy.
Mm-hmm.
We are learning. We're coming out of this dark, shadowy stuff and getting into what's real, I think.
Amazing.
Slowly, but surely. We got more evolving to do.
Oh, absolutely.
I think you can do it through our consciousness. That's going to be the next big study. AI is going to take over if we're not careful, but that's maybe okay. I don't think so. But I think we have to evolve. We have to answer the issues through the stuff we run into on this earth.
Mm-hmm.
We can't be an issue. Can't be a. Well, I need my nap. I'm sorry, guys. I'm
it's all good.
Thought pattern there. But anyway, we just have to get better. We
can't
keep destroying each other and war. And we're a warring species, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And we get away from that. The earth can't evolve anymore. The earth is a living entity too.
Right.
Care of it. I think that's what brings the aliens here a lot, is because I think they don't want us to do that. They want to save the planet.
I fully believe the earth is at some level a whole living thing. We talk a lot. So I'm kind of famous for the intelligent fungus thing. This giant neural network of fungus that live everywhere on the Earth, from Antarctica to the deep sea vents to the upper atmosphere, you can't get away from fungus, and they're able to interspecies communicate. We just did a study this past year where we found out fungus can count. So I kind of think that they are maybe the nerve system of the planet, to where, because they're everywhere and they're interconnected and they talk to each other. But I think you're 100% saying, like, we. As a species, we have to come together and move on to the next step, or we're going to go extinct. I mean, the Earth will be fine no matter what. The Earth will always bounce back from everything that's been thrown at it, but we won't.
If we don't nuke it first.
Right, right.
I mean, that's
why I think aliens...
Sorry.
Aliens interfere with that. Well, aliens don't want us to nuke it. That's what they're concerned with. I think there's been several attempts I just think they will interfere and they will stop us from destroying it, I think. But we can always override that, or try to anyway. It's a lot more to come, and we're getting to the end of it. I think we've got to learn love and compassion with everything, and don't be a victim. That's what I was trying to think about a while ago.
Because
we're here to learn. We're here for experiences, and we're here to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And if you consider yourself a victim, you're never going to learn anything. If you just figure, you know, like I tell my grandkids, you either win or you learn something. No such thing as losing.
100%.
Another t-shirt for you.
There we go.
Another one.
Four t-shirts. Well, Ron, I think that's... if you're good, that's a perfect episode for us. Do you want to shout out your stuff again? And I'll have everybody at home, I'll have his website down below. Buy everything he has. I have.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Well, I got two CDs and two books. And the first book is Voices in the Wilderness, and that's my chronicle, really, of doing this. I wrote it first, and it's got a link, too, for the sounds. I want to get into the context of the sound I'm talking about. You can hear the sound. You just have to download it. And I think there's like 24 or 25 sound bites in it. And then the Quantum Bigfoot is just where it's taken me, and the answers to the anomalies that we were faced up there, what I think is the answers. And really, I got two CDs. One of them is narrated by Jonathan Frakes, Star Trek Enterprise, Next Generation.
Nice.
I narrate the second one, and they're two different. They got sounds integrated in them. Everything is downloadable too, or you can get the hard copy of the books. I don't ship out the CDs anymore. It's just too much of a hassle. So mm-hmm. order the books and they get shipped out from Amazon.
Awesome.
So it's ronmorehead.com. 1-0-M-O-R-E-H-E-A-D.
And then once again, I'll have that in the link below for everybody. It'll be the first link. It's Ron's links.
Simple enough.
But before we go, Ron, we have a tradition with every guest we have on here. Basically, we'll count down from three, and then we'll all yell bye, and then it'll you know, we'll be done. If you're good with that, we'll do that.
Okay. Three, two, one, or one, two, three?
Three, two, one. Good. Okay. I've never been asked. A year and a half, nobody's ever asked.
Yeah.
Everybody's just like, okay. All right. Three, two, one.
Two.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to the Crypts of the Corn podcast.
Please share with a friend you think would like us. It's the best way to help our show grow.
Leave a comment, rate us, a 5-star review, and remember, there is always extra content on Patreon/CryptsOfTheCorn.com.
And don't forget, stay magical.